Welcome back to Our World with Black Enterprise. Are men and women equal in our society? Where do we stand on gender justice? Here to talk about it are Salamisha Tillett, Assistant Professor of English and Africana Studies at the University of Pennsylvania and co-founder of A Long Walk Home, Byron Hurt, gender activist and award-winning filmmaker, and Akiba Solomon, Colorlines.com columnist. Thank you all for joining us.
Thank you.
You
know, there's so much conversation today about race. Even if people don't like it, they're talking about race, they're talking about poverty, they're talking about economics. One thing that rarely gets talked about are issues of gender. What's going on? Why is that?
Well, I think the basic answer to the question is that men and women, like you said, aren't, the question was, are they valued the same? And men and women aren't valued the same in our society. It's not unique to the United States, but I think that you can see this on so many different levels, whether it's equal pay, right? And women don't fare the same as men in workplace, whether it's the jobs women have and women's work being considered less valuable, and whether it's women's bodies, and whether it's reproductive justice or sexual violence, women are just seen as lesser than men in our society.
But why isn't there outcry to this, Byron? I mean, why don't people care? I mean, there's racial inequality, and there's at least an outcry. If people don't agree, they at least talk about it. This gender stuff seems to get hidden.
Well, Mark, I think that women care, but I think a lot of men don't care. And I think that's the big issue. I think more men have to become more invested in the issues. And I think more men have to see how things like gender violence, for example, and gender inequality really affects us as men as well, particularly gender violence, because a lot of men grow up with women in their lives who are abused in some way, whether it's rape or sexual assault or sexual violence, any sort of battering. And, you know, they don't know it, they don't understand it, they don't believe that it happens, and we don't really associate it with the women in our lives, you know. And I think if we associated more with the women in our lives, then we would care more about the issue.
I mean, Akiba, that's interesting, because you would think as black people who have had a history of oppression and marginalization and so forth, that we would respond differently to gender injustice. Why is it that black people, like other races, don't deal with the gender issues in the way that we probably could?
I mean, I think there's a particular dynamic among black people where we really want to be unified. We want to present a unified front at all times. There's a lot of discussion around the endangerment of black men through the lens of things like police brutality, mass incarceration, lack of employment. And I think that a lot of the conventional wisdom around that is we need to handle black men's problems first, because black men are a lot more challenged than we are. And in the process of trying to repair black men, quote unquote, we're getting lost in the sauce, essentially. And in a way, it seems as if we're race traitors if we bring up our own concerns.
Well, I also think that, you know, all the things that you listed in terms of issues that are related to black men are issues that also affect black women, right?
Exactly.
So whether it's unemployment,
exactly,
mass incarceration, police brutality.
Mm-hmm.
And so the problem is that you have all of these things affecting black women, and then you have another list of things on top of that are affecting black women. So it's a failed strategy not to address the ways in which these different things impact black women, primarily because black women historically and presently are the ones who've been on the front lines of social justice movements as well. And also because so many families are headed by black mothers, that if we don't deal with the way in which racial and gender trauma affects them, then we actually are just really creating a further crisis in our community.
Byron, one of the things you talk about in your film, Beyond Beats and Rhymes, is this gender dynamic, right? Particularly how, not only how sexism and misogyny and all these things are dealt with, but how men respond to it. How is this playing out in popular culture?
Well, I do a lot of work with boys and men around the country. I've spoken to thousands of men in high schools, colleges, fraternity settings, sports settings, all over the country. And there's a lot of defensiveness, you know? A lot of guys are very, very defensive when talking about these issues. And there's also a lot of deflection, Mark. I mean, there's always this sort of pushing the issue back onto the woman as if the woman is the source of the problem, and that we can't be self-critical. We can't think about our own attitudes, our own behaviors. Well, that deflection does not allow us to be self-critical. It does not allow us to really look inside ourselves to examine our attitudes and to examine our behavior. So I see a lot of defensiveness and deflection. However, what I will say is, once you engage men in a conversation, once you have a really open, honest, sincere conversation about our attitudes, our behaviors, and the way that we've been raised as men to see women, you begin to see a shift. That's been my experience.
And that's interesting because one of the things that I saw in the last few months or even the last year has been the response to this Chris Brown thing. As you all know, Chris Brown physically assaulted, he's admitted to it, physically assaulted Rihanna. Mm-hmm. And the first thing that people said, black men and black women, is that, you know, she must have done something to cause. I mean, the collective response mm-hmm. from men and women was, you know, something other than holding him accountable. Why does something like that happen?
Well, I think with issues of domestic violence or sexual violence, it's they're the only two crimes really in which the victim is blamed for the attack against them, right? So with Chris Brown, we're all sort of conditioned to have this knee-jerk response to blame the victim. And there's a couple of reasons why that's true. One, because a lot of women may feel, you know, that's a sense of, if they identify with Rihanna, they may feel powerless, they may feel that they don't want to over-identify with the victim, and so therefore she must be at fault. There must be something about her behavior, whether it's sexual or social, that warrants him beating her. But also I think with the Chris Brown Rihanna scenario, there's another element to it, which is also race, in which Chris Brown recently critiqued the media's response to Charlie Sheen, right? Charlie Sheen's a well-known batterer, right. And yet with white men, there is a sense in which they can get away with even more stuff than black men, right? So I think with...
So that conversation still becomes about...
Race.
Race instead of gender.
Exactly.
So even when we're talking about a gender issue, race yes. begins to trump it. Byron, what's something that we can do to think about gender justice in a different way?
Well, I think from a man's perspective, I think that we have to have more men who are willing to educate boys and men around gender issues. I think that we have to have much more, we have to redefine what it means to be a man, and mm-hmm. we have to have men who are willing to redefine masculinity and teach young boys how to redefine it. And I also think that mm-hmm. we need a lot more gender violence prevention education mm-hmm. at early ages mm-hmm. so that young boys can see what some of those power dynamic is mm-hmm. and what we need to do to sort of shift the power dynamic and make things more fair and equitable for women.
Akiba, I'm gonna give you the last word. Is it possible to have a world where there's gender justice? Do you see that as a possibility for us in the near future?
I think it's a possibility. I think that we have to really invest in that idea. We have to imagine what that future looks like, and then we actually have to have honest conversations with one another, whether they're formal or informal, about what's really happening. And once we have those honest conversations, we'll be good.
Well, I appreciate you all for this honest conversation. Salamisha Tillett, Byron Hurd, Akiba Solomon, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
And if you have a topic that you'd like us to cover, email us at ourworld@blackenterprise.com.
The STEM focus is really my focus and my passion.